It was triumph for the Hammers back in 1964. Preston North End are beaten, and West Ham win the FA Cup for the first time. And they do it again in 1975. This time, Fulham are beaten at Wembley. 5 years later, it's Arsenal's turn to be cast aside, now by a rare Trevor Brooking header.
Rice. He's gone past Rice and Torben. There's a lovely cross coming in there. David Cross, Pearson, Brooking with the header! The Hammers have done it again.
So, Billy Bonds lifts that famous old trophy again, the prelude to a homecoming down the streets of London's East End, that for its fervour and for its warmth, well, that would be almost impossible to match. They're blowing bubbles more joyously than ever, and it's one big happy Hammers family. There's always been something special about them, and Ron Greenwood will be talking about the players and that special West Ham philosophy. Ernie Gregory, player and coach for 51 years at Upton Park, will tell us about the old days there. And Trevor Brooking, one of West Ham's proudest sons, will complete the picture as we come to the present day. It's a fascinating story, and it takes us from the turn of the century when the club was formed, one of the oldest team photographs here, through the 20s and 30s when they continue to pack them in at Upton Park, a sea of cloth caps and happiness, the arrival of Ron Greenwood, and the start of a new era in the 1960s. Past the glories of Bobby Moore, Jeff Hurst and Martin Peters, here welcomed back to Upton Park in 1966 after that World Cup triumph, and we get a glimpse of that potent Cotty-McAvenny partnership.
McAvenny had stayed onside. The flag was down. He has Cotty up in support here. Is this three? It is! Well, the partnership is stuck again.
And see again the Littlewoods Cup triumph against Liverpool.
Devonshire now finding Brady. Onto that left foot again. Floated in there towards Kelly. Martin trying to get in there as well. And a goal!
West Ham have always been known as a club with a family warmth about it, from the day these crossed Hammers were born with the club in the summer of 1895 as Thames Ironworks. Hence the cry we hear so often these days, "Come on, you Irons!" Well, their first home was at the Hermit Road ground in Canning Town. The club formed when the Ironworks Gazette informed its readers that a Mr. T.H. Taylor, working in the shipbuilding department, had undertaken to get up a football club for next winter. What we have today all stem from that. The owner of the ironworks, Arnold Francis Hills, offered the new club his support, and they were off and running. His portrait hangs in the boardroom at Upton Park to this very day. There's a story that this team actually played a floodlit game back in December 1895, with light bulbs strung on a row of poles and a ball regularly dipped in a bucket of whitewash. Soon they moved to a new stadium, the Memorial Grounds, also in Canning Town. Arnold Hills wishing that as well as the Ironworks football team playing there, they should also be athletics and cycling in the stadium. In 1898, they were admitted to the Southern League, and on the 5th of July 1900, the Ironworks team became a limited company known as West Ham Football Club. Incidentally, one of the directors in 1900 was J.W. Jimmy Kearns, the grandfather of the present chairman, Len Kearns, and there's been a member of that family on the board from that day to this. Sid King, whose playing career was cut short by a badly broken leg, became the first manager, and he remained secretary manager until 1933. That's him in the back row on the left, in the suit and the trilby. And he was in charge when in September 1904, they moved to the present Boleyn Ground, and this is the earliest picture of it, taken in 1905. Popular players came and went, none more so than the splendid centre-forward named Sid Puddiford. His goals helped give West Ham a stature that eventually saw them elected to the Football League in 1919. 4 years later, they were at Wembley for the stadium's first FA Cup final. By now, Puddiford had moved to Falkirk, but Ted Houghton, a goalkeeper who was to play 13 seasons for West Ham, had arrived. George Kay, a wonderful centre-half, came from Belfast Celtic, and he eventually became Liverpool's manager and won the 1947 championship for them. The legendary goal scorer Vic Watson, He'd cost £50 when signed from Wellingborough, and he scored over 300 goals for West Ham and later Southampton. Sid Bishop was a talented wing half, and Jack Tresidon was a partner in the half-back line. And flying down the left wing was Jimmy Ruffle, spotted in the Ilford Electricity Works 11, and Jimmy made 548 appearances for the club, a record finally beaten by Bobby Moore in 1974, and then overhauled by Billy Bonds. So, off to the 1923 Cup Final, the first held at Wembley. So that's what the best-dressed footballers of 1923 were wearing, as the Hammers made a pre-match inspection of the pitch. But West Ham looked more relaxed when at last they got into their working clothes, a lovely old team picture this, and how that final against Bolton Wanderers caught the public's imagination. Vast crowds, it became known, of course, as the White Horse Final. West Ham lost it 2-0. The players received no bonus, their usual £8 wage packet, but they went on that season to reach the First Division. And it was about now that the famous Bubbles song, West Ham's anthem, was heard. It's said to be aimed at a West Ham youngster called Murray, who had curly hair that looked like a sea of bubbles. In 1932, Charlie Painter took over as team manager, but he couldn't prevent West Ham being relegated that season. Even so, the newsreel cameras came down to West Ham to see Charlie and his men. Through the 1930s, the fans still had their favourites in this great family club. Joe Cockcroft made 263 appearances. Charlie Bicknell, 149. John Morton, 275. Dick Walker, 311. And the hugely popular Jim Barrett made an amazing 467 appearances between 1924 and 1939, some servant Big Jim. Ernie Gregory, who arrived as a fresh-faced 16-year-old goalkeeper in 1936, remembers those days, the great players under manager Charlie Painter.
Well, we used to call him Uncle Charlie, and he really, you know, really looked after us. And if we'd done anything wrong, he put us in our place, and he really had a go at you. But after that, fair enough, everything's okay. And he really, really looked after to make sure everything was right and put the discipline there. I don't think I missed a coach or missed a train all the years I played, the 24 years I played. Well, I turned pro 39, and my wages, I'm not sure, I think it was 5 and 4. You couldn't get no more, and that's a 17-year-old boy.
£5 a week?
£5 a week and £4. £5 in the first team, £4 in the reserves. And that was money, it was great. You know, I mean, that's when I bought my first Crombie overcoat, and you could go to 50 Bob Taylor's, and that's it. And I was well off, you know.
Did he get good players together?
Len Gordon played for England, inside left. Jackie Morton, outside left, played for England. And he had a little fella playing behind them, Joe Cockcroft. I think he should have been playing for England. That was a triangle movement, a really fantastic three. You had Dick Walker, a centre-half. We bought Archie McCauley from the Rangers, inside right. And young Norman Corbett, he came in to the side. So he had the makings of a good side. But 1939, war came along and spoilt it all.
Wasn't there a fella called Barrett?
Jim Barrett, he was a skipper for 11 years, West Ham, at centre-half. Dick Walker took over in 36, yes, 36, but Jim was a wonderful character, really a comedian, and great player. And I had the luck to play behind him as a kid, you know, about 15, 16-year-old, and what wonderful experience it was. He used to talk to you all the time, putting you in the picture, you know, and telling you where to put the ball, and really helping you a lot.
And when you look back, do you think footballers in that lifetime of football that you've enjoyed, do you think footballers in your playing day were probably even happier than they are today?
I personally think so. We used to enjoy our football. We used to love it. Never think, no, I suppose we were a bit silly, really. You never thought about money. until you come round the way. You used to get paid every Tuesday. You used to have a little envelope. Today you need a case.
So they were happy days. Manager Charlie Painter looked to men like Len Goulden, a chirpy inside forward later to join Chelsea, as he built for the future. Ted Fenton arrived in 1933. He'd been a West Ham and England schoolboy, and he would eventually take over from Charlie as manager. And Ted Fenton was in the side when West Ham went to Wembley next. It was June 1940. Dunkirk had just been evacuated. The Battle of Britain was about to begin. But West Ham had business in that famous old stadium against Blackburn Rovers in a wartime replacement of the FA Cup.
The kick-off is at 6:30. West Ham are expected to win and they hardly disappoint their fans. Right from the start, they seem to have that little extra brilliance which puts them just on top of the hard-working, energetic Blackburn Rovers. But right from the start, it's a grand game. Time and again, West Ham attacked with short passes down the centre. Time and again, they looked like scoring, only to be frustrated by superb work by Barron in the Blackburn goal. But always there's the threat of one of those West Ham drives breaking through. And after 35 minutes, one does, to put West Ham one up. And that's how it stays until half-time, with West Ham leading by 1-0. In the second half, Blackburn get in some superb spells of attacking. And once or twice, they come very near to getting an equalising goal. But West Ham hold their advantage. And the first cup final of this war comes to the usual roaring end, with Mr. Alexander presenting the cup to West Ham United.
Sammy Small scored the goal that brought much-needed celebration to a soon-to-become-battered East End of London. Indeed, before the war had ended, a flying bomb had demolished part of Upton Park. And by now, a young amateur named Eddie Chapman had joined the club, and he was to stay with them as player, then secretary, then chief executive, through to the mid-1980s. He helped Charlie Painter get players together for these wartime games. The famous old chicken run had to stay roofless, but through the late 1940s, West Ham remained just an average second division side. This is a moment from a match against Spurs, another second division side then. And here, the visitors were Coventry City. In 1950, Ted Fenton returned as West Ham's manager, still in his 30s, when Charlie Painter retired. Now it was a time for building for the future. And just look at the talent. In the back row from the left in this 1955-56 team, Dave Sexton, John Bond, Ernie Gregory, Malcolm Allison, Noel Cantwell, and Frank O'Farrell. And in the front from the left, Malcolm Musgrove, Harry Hooper, Billy Dare, John Dick, such a prolific scorer, and Ken Tucker. At last, things began to move, and in 1956, West Ham were involved in a classic sixth-round FA Cup tie against Tottenham at White Hart Lane.
Here's a West Ham attack, and the visitors are awarded a free kick. West Ham still attacking. Billy Dare passes out to the left wing, and in front of the Spurs' goal mouth, it's centred again for a duel between Fone and goalie Reynolds. Now to Harry Hooper, who shoots, but the defenders clear it to left winger George Robb, who takes it away. West Ham's right wing Hooper passes to John Dick. Dick to Fone. Fone back to Dick, who shoots, and it's a goal. And when Dick does it again, within 2 minutes, Spurs really have to look to their laurels. They counter-attack fiercely. And the attack nearly comes off, but the ball is handled. Spurs appeal for a penalty, which the ref allows. Tommy Harmer takes it and scores. Spurs 1-2. But wonderboy John Dick does the hat-trick, and now Spurs are again 2 behind, but not for long. From a corner kick, Spurs winger George Robb heads it in for the 5th goal in 16 minutes. Second half, and the excitement's terrific. Another Spurs corner, but it's cleared to Ken Tucker, who wriggles past the attackers while West Ham supporters breathe again. Now it's Spurs on the defensive again, but the ball goes over the bar. Spurs right wing on the move, all out for the equaliser. And from Robb's pass, Len Dukeman bangs it home.
Sadly for West Ham, Spurs won the replay 2-1 at Upton Park. but the seeds of success had started to take root. Early in the 1957-58 season, West Ham lost Malcolm Allison, struck down by tuberculosis, and his influence had been enormous. And in October, they bought Vic Keeble, a centre-forward from Newcastle United, for £15,000. He scored 19 goals in 29 games, and by the end of that season, West Ham were back in the First Division. Reg Pratt, West Ham's chairman and a lifelong supporter, on the right here with King Olaf of Norway, he put it perfectly. If you want something badly enough, you'll get it in the end, he said. Well, West Ham had waited 26 years for this promotion season. But within 2 years of winning promotion, and after a series of bad results, Ted Fenton had left, and the club was about to embark on a new and exciting era with Ron Greenwood as the manager. He'd been assistant manager at Arsenal, and he was a great admirer of the Hungarian style of play.
I had ideas of how a club should be run. I was very continental-minded because of my Hungarian background, and I was very conscious of that. And so I set up the club in the sense of more or less like a continental side, wanted to play that type of football. I had the players. There was a lot of movement. Older players had to go, new players had to come in. But there was a nucleus of young players there, Martin Peters, Jeff Furst, Bobby Moore, Ronnie Boyce. So that was something to work on.
Ron saw West Ham win the FA Youth Cup in brilliant fashion against Liverpool, and then he took his senior players to a club tournament in America that helped them get to know each other and laid the foundations for the new style of West Ham football.
We came back the following year and won the FA Cup in 64. The following year in 65 we won the European Cup, beat 1860 Munich at Wembley. And the whole thing was bubbling and everything was nice, and it really was. And the supporters were tremendous because they'd never seen anything like this before. And of course we had players like Moore, Hurston, Peters, Ronnie Boyce, Jackie Burkitt, Joe Kirkup, and Jim Stanton, who I'd signed as a goalkeeper, Kenny Brown, John Bond, and the whole thing about it. Johnny Sissons and Nelly Redknapp came from the youth side and played in the first team. The thing was bubbling and what have you. And this went on for quite a while, and we were always entertaining.
On the pitch, West Ham in 1964 got that Wembley feeling. This after a momentous FA Cup semi-final against Manchester United at Hillsborough.
Law performs a captain's first duty by winning the toss, and a crowd of 65,000 forget the conditions as the great semi-final begins. Manchester in white, though how long that will last remains to be seen. The Hammers' outside left, John Sissons, is soon prominent, but it's the Manchester men who make the first real attack. West Ham goalkeeper Jim Stanton isn't troubled, and the Londoners look dangerous. Here's an escape for Manchester United. Best tries his luck, but fortune favours the West Ham defence. And in this first half, neither side scores. Manchester United kick off after the interval, and what a fine game it's turned out to be despite the ghastly conditions. West Ham are in top form, which means they're as good as any side in the country. If they keep up this pressure, they must get a goal soon. Their supporters don't have to wait long. Boyce scores the Hammers' first goal. On come West Ham again and win a corner. John Sissons places the kick well. Jack Burkitt passes to Boyce, and it's goal two for the Hammers. Manchester United fight back in the way they've so often done in cup ties. Dennis Law's stimulating goal then put them back in the game. Inside left, Jeff Hurst clinches matters with West Ham's third goal. West Ham are jubilant. They'll meet Preston in the final.
And so on to that final against Preston.
Moore wins the toss. For Preston, Alex Dawson kicks off. Luckily for Preston, left-back Jim Smith is first to the ball, and the Northerners look dangerous. That stings the Londoners into retaliation. Inside left, Jeff Hurst is tackled by Tony Singleton. Kelly save. Again, it's Preston with outside left Doug Holden menacing West Ham. There's no holding Preston, and after 9 minutes, Doug Holden puts the ball in the net. This is the time for West Ham to pull something out of the bag. A good pass finds John Sissons, and it's the equaliser. Back in the game, West Ham try again, but Jeff Hurst's header is well saved. Preston go all out to regain the lead. Standen concedes a corner. Wilson takes the kick. Centre forward Alex Dawson heads a goal. Preston lead 2-1. Bring on the guard man. West Ham kickoff. A goal down, remember. It's a safe bet. They've had a pep talk during the interval. Anyway, they lose no time showing the fighting spirit that got them into the final. Outside right, Peter Braybrook is challenged by Jim Smith. Not quite successfully, a corner for West Ham. Braybrook's kick is just what the Hammers ordered. Centre half, Ken Brown is there. Not quite on target. Jeff Hurst does better. And yes, sir, Alan Kelly just fails to keep the ball out. That all happened so quickly, let's see just how West Ham scored the equaliser. Obviously time for West Ham to go into a huddle. Another corner for West Ham. And another escape for Preston. This looks like developing into a goal-mouth scramble, which West Ham will do well to survive. Preston centre-forward Alex Dawson finds Standen unbeatable. Jeff Hurst makes ground, then passes to Braybrook. A promising move. We'll follow it in slow motion. And almost in the last seconds of the game, West Ham inside right Ronnie Boyce heads into the net. And this is just how it happened. West Ham's third goal, which won them the cup. Johnny Byrne starts a one-man training session. Bobby Moore, captain of West Ham, captain of England, and at this moment, happy as any man alive, leads his men to receive the trophy and winner's medal. Lord Harwood represents the Queen. A lap of honour now by the 11 excited men who have won the most highly prized sporting trophy in the world. The general verdict, the best final for many a year.
Mind you, Ron Greenwood was soon back at the basics with the club's young players. And I wonder if you recognise the future star standing second from the right, a young Trevor Brooking. Ron Greenwood looking to the future, but within a year, he'd taken West Ham back to Wembley for the final of the European Cup Winners' Cup against 1860 Munich of West Germany. And that was to prove a very special night.
Germans in thousands leaven the mass of West Ham supporters as the big game began, the Hammers kicking off. Every Londoner in the 100,000 crowd remembered manager Ron Greenwood's words. Getting to Wembley is nothing. The thing is to win there. Brave words. And 11 determined players began on the attack. Munich in white easily survived the early onslaught and went into the attack themselves. Back came the Hammers. A pass found inside left ear, but he was offside. West Ham corner here, and a poor clearance gave them a second chance. Munich were rescued from danger by their star goalkeeper, Radenkovic. Neither side had scored at the interval.
The visitors kicked off on the resumption and soon showed something of the skill that's brought them fame on the continent. Safe as a rock, Jim Standen was a tower of strength all through the match. West Ham played better and better as the game went on. Another attempt now by Brian Deer, not quite on target. A splendid chance now for West Ham. The ball went to Seeley. And he punched it home. No goal, of course. Now Munich took up the running, but without any luck. Long deferred reward came to the Hammers after 68 minutes. A pass from Boyce went to Seeley. This time it really was a goal. Deer was fouled by the goalkeeper. That meant a free kick for West Ham. Bobby Moore placed the kick well. And Seeley scored again. West Ham was still attacking when the whistle went for full time. What a night for West Ham as Bobby Moore received the trophy from the president of the European Union of Football Association. The whole country is proud of the Hammers, winners of the European Cup Winners' Cup.
The final was perfection, really. Mm. And I said to somebody as I was walking off, I said, well, at long last, we've showed the rest of Europe that we can play like them, and that was my proudest moment, I felt, you know.
Around this time, things were happening at Upton Park as well. A few years earlier, the North Bank had got a roof, the West Stand was given an extra block, and soon, the dear old Chicken Run would be pulled down to be replaced by the East Stand. Bobby Moore, Jeff Hurst, Martin Peters returned to Upton Park as World Cup heroes at the start of the 1966-67 season, and rightly, they got a hero's welcome.
Peters scored one of the goals in the World Cup final. The captaincy of Bobby Moore was well nigh perfect, like his play. As for Jeff Hurst, well, he did the hat-trick.
Jimmy Greaves, who later came to West Ham from Spurs in a swap for Martin Peters, stayed only a short time. But Jimmy had his moments in a West Ham shirt.
Bobby Moore to pump it back again. Hurst looking to get underneath it. And does so. Greaves! Oh, Greaves! He's done it! Jimmy Greaves! The goal he wanted!
John Lyle in 1971 became Ron Greenwood's assistant. And here is a youthful Lyle with some schoolboy hopefuls.
Right the way over. Nice touch. Right the way over. Off you go, there and back.
Billy Bonds and Trevor Brooking had begun to fashion so much of West Ham's thinking on the field. First, Billy Bonds. This is an early goal, and it came in a 3-0 win at Crystal Palace in 1971, when young Addy Coker and the long-serving and popular Clyde Best were also Hammers scorers.
Bobby Killard, right in that goal mouth there, the corner coming up, and Bonds going for it. And Cooker! He scored! The young lad, 17, playing in his first game. 7 minutes gone, and a rocket-like shot that gave Jackson no chance. What a start for him! Delighted! And there's Redknapp going in! What a terrible mistake there in the Palace defence. As Jackson and McCormick looked at each other, and Redknapp very nearly nipped in for what could have been a second and killer goal. Bonds now, letting one go. And again they looked and waited, and Robson was there very quickly, a nice little chip towards Billy Bonds, and he scored a second one! 2-0 Billy Bonds, and Crystal Palace defence was in ruins. Taylor doggedly is trying to stay with Billy Bonds. Bonds a little cross, and Clyde Best the goal. Number three, Clyde Best.
he was tremendous. He came as a young, he came as a right back, of course, and he grew in stature all the time he was at West Ham. He was a tremendous athlete, set great standards on fitness, and he was a leader as well. But it was interesting, really, how the situation arose that he became captain, because Frank Lampard really should have been captain. But Frank had, when Bobby had gone to Fulham, you know, we'd sold Bobby to Fulham, Frank made a statement about the fact that he felt that he'd like to leave the club as well. And so consequently, after Bobby had gone, I felt that, well, you can't make somebody who wants to leave the club as well captain. So I made Billy captain. That's how Billy became captain, really, in a default of Frank Lampard.
In that same season, there was a thrilling 3-3 draw against Derby County when Trevor Brooking made his mark.
Now Best. Starting it again there. Hurst to leap for it. McDowell in there too. And Lampard hit.
Over Webster's head and Hurst now. Best. Turning again for Robson with a shot. Harried, what a goal! Brian Robson. 2-1 to West Ham. And so the young West Ham fullback taking it up now. Is Skipper outside him? Bobby Moore. Cross first time there towards Hurst at the far side, but again McFarlane's head was there. Brooking. Still Brooking. Yes!
A tremendous player and such an assuming type of lad, really. Never really lauded it about his skill. He was shy and retiring almost to a degree of, you know, the lads used to take the mick out of him, you know. But he could take all that, and he laughed, you know, ha ha ha, you know, his usual stuff. And then of course he was in the England side. And when he was in the England side with me, of course, West Ham got relegated, and Trevor was very concerned about his position in the England side. I said, well, it doesn't matter what team you're playing in, first division, third division, you're still an England player. And that kind of helped him to stay at West Ham, I think.
Well, Ron Greenwood, I think, was the person who really introduced the West Ham philosophy of the football that they've played. And I think a lot of supporters of other clubs, one of their second or third clubs is often West Ham because of the style of football they play. It's entertaining and attacking, and Ron's whole coaching beliefs really centred in training around working with the ball, being comfortable in possession, getting good habits, passing, control, and really attacking. And that, I think, probably as much as anything is why I enjoyed, I think, from staying at the club 19 years, people often say, well, why did you stay at the club that long? Didn't you want to move on? But when it becomes your profession, you then still very fortunate if you look forward to the matches and still enjoy them. Whereas, you know, when you're playing just for fun, sometimes you can have an easy weekend or whatever. But at West Ham, the style of football we played, particularly my own role as an attacking midfield player, meant I always was looking forward to the matches. And that really was down to Ron as such.
And of course, you would immediately have come under the influence in some way, shape or form of Bobby Moore, Jeff Hurst and Martin Peters. Now tell me about the influence that those three would have had on West Ham at that time.
Well, of course, the year of the World Cup final, 66, I mean, England won the World Cup, but any West Ham supporter will tell you, in fact, it was West Ham, because Bobby was the captain, Jeff Hurst got a hat-trick in the final, and of course, Martin got the other goal. So there was a lot of attention focused. Bobby, being the skipper at West Ham and England, was obviously a very huge figure in the footballing world. I mean, a little bit overawed, I think, as a youngster when you first came to the club, Bobby Moore. But he settled you down very quickly. I think his great strength was his use of the ball from the back. I mean, probably Beckenbauer, West Germany, but Bobby's in that category. I mean, he used to find people superbly. So, you, as a youngster, you looked at his sort of passing ability as much as his reading of the game. Martin Peters being a midfield player, and that was more my role. You watched Martin, although I must admit he scored a lot more goals than me. But Martin was the midfielder, they called him the ghost, didn't he? Because he came into the penalty box late and scored a number of goals. And of course, Jeff Hurst, who started off in midfield, and then Ron Greenwood put him up front, and really everything happened from there.
Jeff Hurst was still around in 1972 when West Ham had a dramatic series of League Cup semi-finals against Stoke City. The scores were level on aggregate at 2-2 when Jeff Hurst stepped up to take a penalty against Gordon Banks at Upton Park. Now, if he scored, West Ham were at Wembley.
And now it's Hurst against Banks, and Banks has saved it miraculously, and the crowd are stunned and Stoke are delighted.
So to two playoff games before it was settled, and again it was agony for West Ham, this time at Old Trafford.
Redknapp takes the throw, back to McDowell, and there's the ball given away to Ritchie, and that's a penalty. McDowell absolutely lost his head. Bernard against Bobby Moore. It must be 100-1 against, and he saved it, and there's the rebound. Bonds, and still going, and he's found space. And it's deflected in! Bonds wins it. Best is waiting in the middle. And it's there by Brookie! Conroy for Easton. And now Doving. He's found the net! Bernard. Green off through the middle, and overlapping here on the right is Marsh. Come out to Conroy! And that is it! So Stoke City, the side who have never won a major championship, a major trophy of any sort, are in with a chance. They know go to Wembley to play Chelsea in the final of the Football League Cup.
Jeff Hurst was soon to move to Stoke City after 499 games and 248 goals for West Ham, some record that. But glory still eluded the Hammers, although they stayed respectably in the First Division and continued regularly to get the better of big city clubs.
And Lee in so much space, and a goal! Well, Lee opens his arms and says, well, I could hardly believe I'd get that amount of space. Now, can West Ham pull back that one-goal deficit in the last minute of the first half? Best. Played for Lampard. Forward now for Brooking. Is this the chance? And it is! Trevor Brooking! 1-1. Moore. Gould. Nice layoff again for Patton. And Patton has gone past Pardo. That's the cross, and it's a good-looking cross, and it's an own goal by Doyle! Well, it was Patton's brilliant work down the left. Good long throw there by Patton. Holton was really stretching for that one. Best jumping well for it. Billy Bonds! Taylor's header, not quite directed the way he wanted it, but now Wooler, oh, and here's a chance for McIlroy, and it's a goal for Manchester United, scored by the substitute Sammy McIlroy. The crowd are giving West Ham all they can. Bonds tries to get it, there's a header there, yes!
Two victories then from the 1973-74 season, the same season that West Ham faced two hugely significant shifts. Bobby Moore decided it was time to leave after 544 league and 98 cup games. What a fabulous servant he'd been. And Ron Greenwood, unknown to the West Ham board, was about to make another surprise announcement.
I felt that it was time for a change, and I was wanting to run the club, as I said earlier, on the continental line. So I thought to myself, well, what I'll do, I'll make myself general manager. And by then, young John Lyle, I'd brought him up through the youth team. I'd made him assistant manager, got him interested in coaching and everything, because he had to back up, as you know, when he was about 25. And so he was a great pupil, and everything went well. And so I said, well, look, I mean, I always remember the situation. I said to him, I'm going to make you the team manager. And I told the team what I was doing. And what I'd never done was tell the board I was going to do it. Because it was a unique experience. You see, I had an understanding at West Ham with Mr. Pratt, who was the chairman, which was based on faith. I didn't have a contract. I was there 17 years, never had a contract. But it was based on faith with one man, Mr. Pratt. So everything that I did was for the... He knew I was doing it for the good of the club. And when I explained to him, it was the only board meeting I went in with a little fear. I explained what I'd done. They said, oh, dear. But I was expecting I might get the boot because of whatever, because I'd never even told one of them, you know. And so consequently, they said, well, if that's how you believe and that's the thing, the way it should go, let's do it. And so we did, and it worked well.
It was a move that paid dividends. Middlesbrough was soon on the receiving end.
Craggs. Pat to Lampard. Robson, all played on nicely by Robson for Brooking, who's got Gould away on the right. Using their wings well, West Ham. Bobby Gould with a shot, and Robson! Oh, what a goal! Keith Robson! A beautiful goal! Jennings. Oh, and look how Brooking has escaped them all, with Gould in the middle. And it's there! It's an own goal off Bohm! But it's number two, and Brooking, with a smile all over his face, takes the credit. Taylor is up there, looks as though he might have a crack at it. Billy Bond is in there, Graham Paddon is in there, and Lampard is in there. They're really queuing up behind this West Ham free kick. I would fancy Paddon.
Against Wolves a fortnight later, the Hammers hit five.
And Billy Bonds now, with the penalty for West Ham against Phil Parks, an enormous goalkeeper who, to Bonds, must seem to fill that goal now. And Bonds has done it, 1-0 to West Ham. Keith Robson, crossed in towards Bobby Gould. Now it'll come for Brooking, and a goal by Trevor Brooking. 2-0 to West Ham, underneath the goalkeeper. Bonds and Lampard are men who are wide of him. He's looked around to see whether Lampard can do it. Yes! Lampard! A lovely goal! Gone off the boil just for the moment, West Ham, but now can Brooking revive him. That looked like handball, a good decision by the referee. Brooking with a shot, a superb challenge! Now for Brooking. Gould in a lot of space over on this right touchline. Bonds coming in well to join up with the attack. Still with Billy Bonds, and now with Trevor Brooking. He tried to dash it through, Bobby Gould! Yes! Number five, Bobby Gould against his own club. And a fellow who works so hard that you really can't deny him the goal he scored.
The name Robson stands tall in West Ham's scoring in these early 1970s. Brian Pop Robson was regarded by Trevor Brooking as the best finisher he'd played with. And we've just seen some of Keith Robson's work, and Keith was on target again when West Ham launched themselves at Wembley once more. Here they are in a fifth round tie against Queen's Park Rangers, and they had Phil Parks in goal.
Clements now. He's half waiting for a whistle, I think. They're still going on, though. And a goal! Dave Clement! Holland, a little touch off for Brooking. Took him a little further to the right than he wanted, but Holland with a header! Oh, a great goal! attacking Gillard with Jennings outside him, and that worked well for West Ham. A floated cross there towards Keith Robson. Yes!
In the final, Fulham, with Bobby Moore now in their side, were waiting at Wembley. But it was a little-known striker from Rochdale, Alan Taylor, who had Hammers fans cheering that sunlit day in the great old stadium.
As Alan was saying, just lacking this little killer instinct. That's all they're lacking at the moment. Otherwise, as he said, West Ham are there for the taking. But still 0-0. And maybe it'll be West Ham who do the taking as Holland takes it up now, down the left for them. Billy Jennings screaming for the ball, hitting it first time. Miller gets it. Taylor turns it back, yes! Played for Padden, Lampard coming up quickly, letting one really wrap there with his left foot. Holland. Oh, what a good ball by Holland there for Padden. And hit well by Padden, number two! And he's done it again! Alan Taylor!
So, West Ham were in Europe again. One side they faced early on was the Soviet team, Ararat Yerevan.
McDowell. Robson. Played on again for Taylor. Just look at his face, and it might still come for Brooking. West Ham looking a little better now in these last couple of minutes. Patton. Rifling in a left-foot shot. No! No! Yes! Bounced off that stanchion. And here's Alan Taylor. Some nice touches with his head tonight, Alan Taylor. And he's found Pat Holland with that one. There's Alan Taylor again for the return. Delicate little cross there towards Keith Robson. 2-0. Played for Lampard. Nodded on now. Not for Padden, though. Good for Gregorian. And now Petrosian. And it's a goal! And a very good goal indeed. By Petrosian. And now Billy Bonds. Onside. He timed his run well, Coleman. And Keith Robson is coming in fast also. But he couldn't quite play it the first time. He might the second to Alan Taylor. Yes!
Then Den Haag of Holland hammers 4-2 down from the first leg, here with a Dutch commentator in full flow.
Brooking. Lampert komt nu op. Daar is Lampert. Dat is een schot. Goal. Goeiedag. En daar komt weer Taylor. En dan wordt hij te veel gewacht. Het voorgevaren is een penalty. Billy Bonds gaat hem nemen. Daar komt de aanloop. Bonds. En scoort. En zet zijn ploeg op 3-0. Billy Bonds, de captain. Zullen vermoedelijk weer er langs lopen, ja. En nu komt de boogbal. Ah, dat was een goeie. En een goal. Ja, ja.
A real thriller of a semi-final against Eintracht Frankfurt of West Germany.
Lawrence held off him for a moment. Now there's a bit of space for Lampard. Chipped it again towards Brooking. And it's there. Brooking has done it. That's the goal West Ham wanted. It'll come to Brooking. He's played it on to Robson, who's onside. Oh, and he let it go a yard too far. Oh, but a great goal! Keith Robson! Padden. Taylor. Brooking, beautiful timing. Still Brooking. Yes, number three! Magnificent! Bonds getting up beneath this one.
This could be dangerous. Beveren, and it's there. The Germans have scored through Beveren.
But West Ham did hold on, and here they are in the final in the IJssel Stadium in Brussels against Anderlecht. And West Ham couldn't have had a better start. A cross here by Billy Jennings, and some good finishing by Patsy Holland. A good knockdown by Billy Bonds with a header, and Patsy Holland giving West Ham the best possible start. It was a lead they held until almost half-time when poor Frank Lampard badly mishit this back pass. The Belgians now in full flight, and here's Robbie Rensenbury keeping his head, finding the net, and that made it 1-1. The Belgians took the lead quite early in the second half, and again it was Rensenbrink to the fore. A great run too by Francois van der Elst, and a good finishing touch by him, and the Belgians are in the lead. But West Ham were far from finished. Trevor Brooking down the left flank now, and a good cross by Brooking met by the head of Keith Robson, and suddenly the West Ham side were level at 2-2. But the last word belonged to Anderlecht. There's a penalty coming up now as Rensenbrink is brought down. And for the second time, the Belgians have the opportunity of taking the lead. Rensenbrink himself takes the spot kick, and that puts them 3-2 into the lead. There was a great final flourish from Anderlecht as Rensenbrink finds Francois van der Elst, soon to join West Ham, of course. A good solo effort by him. And there's the ball in the back of the West Ham net. And West Ham are beaten by 4-2. Next, Ron Greenwood moved on to the England job. He handed over to John Lyle, here receiving one of his regular Bell's Manager of the Month awards. And Ron recalls those days with so much football talk between them.
We used to sit in the car park after games talking about 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. Never went home, you know. It was all to do. He was so thirsty for knowledge and wanted to know everything. And he was a great pupil and, of course, has turned out to be a master himself.
Yeah, I mean, how highly do you rate him as a manager?
One of the best managers in the game, yes.
As high as that?
Yes. Yeah.
However, John Lyle couldn't halt West Ham's skid towards the second division in 1978. Phil Parkes arrived from Queen's Park Rangers, a record £800,000 for a goalkeeper. Alvin Martin stiffened the defence. David Cross had already brought strength and goals to the attack, but still West Ham struggled to get out of Division 2. Still in Division 2, the Hammers went skipping off to Wembley again in 1980. Arsenal now were the hot favourites. After all, they'd won the Cup the previous year, they were beaten finalists the year before that, and they were about to finish fourth in the First Division. But West Ham had a surprise thrust awaiting them. It was a winning goal from Trevor Brooking, and a header too.
And now West Ham forward again with Brooking. A little flick there for Cross, and in fact it comes through to Pearson. And here's Devonshire. Rice. And he's gone past Rice and Talbot. There's a lovely cross coming in there. David Cross, Pearson, Brooking with the header. West Ham in the lead. Pearson helped to make it, but the header belonged to Trevor Brooking.
It happened to drop to Dave Cross, who hit the shot first time. That was blocked by Willie Young, and it went back out to Stuart Pearson. And myself, having wandered into the original cross from Alan Devonshire, then seeing the first shot, I was sort of just standing on the six-yard box, really, enjoying the sort of goal-mouse scramble. When Stuart, as I say, to be honest, did shoot for goal, but as luck would have it, his shot was pulled across the face of the goal and really was going to always just go behind me. And so all I did was sort of fall back slightly and just divert it towards goal. You know, a lot of people say, oh, I hit you on the head and things, but I did know what was happening.
From Her Royal Highness, the Duchess of Kent, the Hammers have done it again. Stuart Pearson, who did all this with Manchester United. Well, he's in tears. Poor Paul Allen is crying his eyes out. And his chairman, Len Kearns, there look concerned. There are smiles here from his teammates. To think when West Ham won this in 1975, he was in his second year as a comprehensive schoolboy. And here he is, Paul Allen. A day and a moment he'll never forget, and he needn't worry about the tears today.
Next season, 1980-81, was truly eventful. For a start, it was a promotion year for the fans trooping towards Upton Park. Paul Goddard had now joined the attack for £800,000, and they saw early on a thriller against Watford.
Callaghan played on first time here for Poskett.
And a turn again for Bissett. And now a chance for Luther Bissett. And Poskett! And Watford ahead!
Devonshire getting that on for Goddard. Played back for Pike. This is Devonshire.
That's in there. That's well, like it crossed! Oh, superb goal for West Ham. What a beauty that was.
And now here's Henderson.
Cross coming in, and Jenkins on the far side with a header! And now back in the lead. No, not Jenkins. It's Jacket, the number three, the 18-year-old.
David Cross. And now Brooking. And now Barnes. Oh, gone past Harrison. Now faced by Bolton.
Oh, he scored! Bobby Barnes, his first league game, and 17 years old, has made it 2-2.
With a minute to go, plus some time to be added on. Devonshire crossing it in there. David Cross. Here's Lampard coming up fast, trying to get to that byline with it. Does so well.
Yes! Trevor Brooking!
Then five goals as Preston were crushed.
A little touch inside
by Goddard for Neva.
And might find Goddard again onside. Oh, and it's in there. I thought for a moment it was over the top. But Goddard has made it count.
Cross, the little touch there for Goddard. Little touch there towards Pike.
It's got to be. And it is.
Alvin Martin's up for it. Billy Bonds is right in there too. Lampard.
Oh! A marvellous goal!
Playing with a bit of style again now, West Ham. Flicked in there for Goddard. Back for Devonshire.
Is it going to be? It is! Superb goal! Brilliant stuff by West Ham.
Brooking for Devonshire.
Number five!
And West Ham won that second division title with 13 points to spare. Well, the Hammers enjoyed another great run to a Wembley final. Here they are in the second leg semi-final of the League Cup against Coventry City. This after losing the first leg 3-2 at Coventry.
Cross, Goddard trying to turn.
Oh, and it's there! By Goddard!
Now it's Lampard. Cross trying to bore his way in there.
Neva with a chance! Jimmy Neva! And West Ham have won it in the last minute!
So that 2-0 win gave them a 4-3 aggregate, and they drew with Liverpool at Wembley in the final, and then came to a replay at Villa Park.
Weighted ball there for Neva, almost the first touch he's had with almost 10 minutes gone. And he's gone past Alan Hansen. And he's got a couple of West Ham players waiting in the middle. The cross coming in. Oh, and it's there.
Well, Goddard has put West Ham into the lead.
Well, it's Liverpool doing some more attacking now. McDermott playing it in.
Dalglish!
So Liverpool's corner, Jimmy Case with it. Curled it there once more towards Hansen!
And the goal!
So defeat there for West Ham. It had also been another season in Europe, with a difference. Hammers were forced to play behind closed doors, but still scored five against Castilla of Spain. It was because of crowd troubles from West Ham fans in Madrid during the first leg.
In the end, sending it up for Pike!
Cross and Martin, the two players on the far post, but Cross meets it. And West Ham go two in front from Trevor Brooking's free kick. David Cross, the scorer.
Chendo is being waved back on. And Castilla back to their full complement.
but it might not be enough to stop Devonshire here. Well, he gets away with a missed kick. Looking on the far post, cross as well, and put in by Goddard. Bernal, and they were caught watching as Bernal came forward with a really marvellous goal for Castiglia. Now Brooking, and now Stewart. Morgan again. There have been very few occasions where West Ham have got their first time passing going, but it's brought them a goal that could be the winner. David Cross. And Devonshire being allowed to run. And Cross gets the hat-trick.
But Hammers were eventually halted by the Soviet side Dynamo Tbilisi. So to the First Division again, and Middlesbrough were early season visitors.
And found Goddard, crossed in by Lampard towards Cross, and it was... Oh, Neighbours right in there. 1-0 for West Ham, Jimmy Neighbour.
Devonshire, Goddard. Devonshire again, looking for a yard, might have to work for it. Flicks it in there to Cross, back it comes again for Goddard.
Oh, and an own goal by Angus Edding. Stewart scored three times this season, each of them from the penalty spot, now with a chance to make it 3-0 to West Ham. Man who really likes to blast them. And he's done it again, 3-0.
West Ham finished ninth that first season back. A great start to the next season, that's 1982-83, included a run of five successive league wins, culminating in the destruction of Liverpool.
Here's Maber coming in on that right touchline. Oh, and it could be there, Martin! Alvin Martin! Goddard. And Goddard again, shrugging off Lawrenson, but it's not as easy as that. But he gets it in for all that tight! And the second goal for West Ham! Clark in danger again of being caught offside, and you shouldn't blame Pike for that. I think he had to keep hold of that one. He was aware that Clark had gone into an offside position. It's with Kennedy. Now Thompson played back again for Graham Souness. And there was no stopping that, and Liverpool are back in it with a goal by Graham Souness. Parks with the goal kick. Nodded on there by Goddard for Neighbour. And Goddard outside him. And Clark coming in fast as well. And Clark has scored! 3-1!
Francois van der Elst, a popular import from Belgium, stayed two seasons and he was a regular scorer. Never better than this effort at White Hart Lane in a 2-1 defeat by Spurs.
Now, Goddard, van der Elst, a great break by him, and a chance for the Belgian to put West Ham into the lead. 1-0. Right in front of the West Ham fans, Francois van der Elst.
But when Spurs came to Upton Park on New Year's Day, Tony Cotty was waiting for them, a 17-year-old making his first appearance for the Hammers, with a match ball after scoring on his debut in front of a boisterous 33,000 crowd.
And that's the art of compromise. The referee got Pike to take the ball back and the wall to go back as well. Gallagher! And Cotty! 17 years old and he scores his first goal in his first game for West Ham.
And Hammers eventually finished in eighth position. They won their first five league games at the start of the next season, including this victory at Tottenham.
Devonshire with the corner, played wide towards Martin in point of fact, just got the touch, and a goal by Whitten, 1-0 West Ham. And here's Swindlehurst, a quick look around to see what might be on. Pike guiding it now for Stewart, played on now this time for Cotty, but Stevens again has gone with him. Now can Cotty get it across? That's a good little cross by him, and another goal by Swindlehurst this time.
However, it turned out to be a season bedeviled by injuries, and the challenge soon faded. Added to which, there was the impending retirement of Trevor Brooking. Brooking's value, as if it needs confirming, was never better shown than in a scrambled 2-2 draw against Queen's Park Rangers.
Brooking again, Lily in the mood. Oh, and that's a delightful ball if Walford could get there. Left foot and a good one, and Pike, and scores! 1-0.
Swindlehurst and Cotty are up as well. That's the ball for Cotty. Inch perfect. A brilliant goal.
Brooking, the maker, but over the years also an immaculate taker of goals. And what a sight this is for all West Ham and England fans.
Brooking trying to send Collins one way, then the other. A curling one! Oh, wonderful goal! The ball to Brooking. Brooking has made a space, and he's gone! Oh, he's flipped his way past Frank Clark. That's not a bad-looking cross either. Brooking hitting one. Brooking!
At Holland to pick up Brookie. Oh, what a nice bit of work. What a good goal! What a good goal!
Rice. And he's gone past Rice and Tor, but there's a lovely cross coming in there. David Cross, Pearson, Brooking with the header! West Ham in the lead. Pearson helped to make it, but the header belonged to Trevor Brooking. Neil with a chance to cross it in there once more, but maybe he'll try and find Koppel down that flank. No, it's in here for Keegan. Played back for Brooking. Terrific goal!
So, to his final farewell, his wife Hilka, children Warren and Colette are there too.
Getting the presentation of a clock from the West Ham chairman, Len Ferns.
So to the next season. No Brooking and no Alan Devonshire, who missed the whole of that campaign through injury. It was undistinguished. They finished 16th. But then Frank McAvenny arrived from St Mirren. He teamed up with Tony Cotty, and they were both on the score sheet when Hammers plundered four goals against Chelsea at Stamford Bridge in 1985-86.
Here's Paris. Dickens, Paris on a marauding run here. Cotty, it's two! Laid on by Paris. McAvenny had stayed onside. The flag was down. He has Cotty up in support here. Is this three? It is! Well, the partnership is stuck again. Oh, McLaughlin misjudged the bounce there. Cotty to McAvenny! Well, would you believe it? That's four!
For a time, it looked as though West Ham would win their first ever league title. In the end, they finished third. Their best ever championship season. McAvenny finished with 28 League and Cup goals, Cotty with 25. 15th place in season 86-87, and few visits now from the TV cameras, but they did catch one riveting performance in the Littlewoods Cup at Watford.
Goddard. A brilliant goal! Paul Goddard! And to the goalkeeper's left. And Watford are level. Thoughtful play here by West Ham. And time for Devonshire now to measure up something. And it's in there by Dickens. Still with Cotty. He's picked up Ward. Driven there by Ward. Magnificent goal.
Now Sterling being pursued by Gale. He's got Allen waiting in the middle.
Billy Bonds' swashbuckling days were coming to an end as a player. It was a worthy award when he received the MBE for his services to football, and a very nice touch too when his fame spread to the American networks.
Professional footballer Billy Bonds, he had been named member of the British Empire. Football has been tainted in this country with crowd violence, but Bonds rises above all this as one of the game's most honest, hardworking practitioners. And the titled and top-hatted crowded for autographs when the news photographers were finished.
Billy Bonds! Oh, a goal by Bonds! What a beauty!
At 41, Bonds is the oldest professional in a league where most are finished at 30. He has played for 24 years, where most play five. There is no way to cheat to get this record. You do it slugging out the daily training. And if it's cold and wet, then you slug it out in the cold and wet.
There's a lot of argument about honors, their worth, and who should win them. In London yesterday, there are many who think the Queen got it right, honoring a bus mechanic's son who left school at 15 to play football, something he does with distinction.
So a moving moment in the career of a great player. 16th place next season, and then zooming sadly towards relegation. Frank McAvenny had gone to Celtic, later to return. Tony Cotty had joined Everton for £2 million. However, even in that relegation season, the quality of the entertainment remained high. How about this thrilling fight back against Nottingham Forest?
And good break here for West Ham with Kelly! West Ham in the lead!
That's the shorter one.
Garber. Brian Rice crossing it in. He's got a good left foot. And on the far side, they've got it in again. It's going to be Clough curling it. And a magnificent goal by Nigel Clough. Rice getting it forward towards Chapman. Looks to got the edge on Martin at the moment. Plays it back again. Hodge! Right, come to Kelly! And they've got it! West Ham aren't finished yet. Ward playing it into Rossignol! A brilliant goal! 3-3!
But all else that season paled alongside a fabulous victory over Liverpool in the Littlewoods Cup, when Paul Ince became the hero of the night.
Devonshire now finding Brady. Antoinette left foot again. Floated in there towards Kelly. Martin trying to get in there as well. And a goal! It's Paul Ince! And he's gone in! And Ince has done it again! 2-1. Brady now to Kelly. Rossignol's made a break through the middle. Too high for him, but not for Staunton. Oh, he's in there! An own goal by Steve Staunton. And 3-1 up. And it's going to be Gale who clips it. He's got it in there! 4-1!
Hammers eventually went out to Luton in the semi-finals. Sadly, at the end of the season, it was also the end of John Lyle's era. A player whose career was cut cruelly short by injury, assistant manager to Ron Greenwood, a manager who twice won the FA Cup, had success in Europe, reached the League Cup final, a coach who produced sides playing football in the true West Ham fashion, but who fell with his team when they were doomed to the second division. Ron Greenwood regards him as the best in the business, which means that Lou Macari has got a big and rich tradition to follow. Can he get those bubbles flying high again?